All right, welcome back, everyone. We're about to start our first session of talks. We've got three talks. Each one is 20 minutes each. They all should be super interesting. So our first talk is from Sebastian Grimberg, who's a senior applied scientist at AWS. And he's going to tell us about PALIS, which is an open source parallel large scale electromagnetics library. Take it away, Sebastian.
Thanks, Will. Hi, everyone. Good morning. Thank you very much for all being here and listening to me talk. As Will said, I'm Sebastian Grimberg. I work at AWS in what's called the AWS Center for Quantum Computing. This is an organization focused on designing and building quantum hardware within AWS. Today, I'm talking about PALIS. PALIS stands for Parallel Large-Scale Computational Electromagnetics. This is a solver for electromagnetics that we developed in our team at AWS based on our needs for simulation in the process of hardware design. My plan for today is to go over what PALIS does, how we use it, some of the core functionality, in addition to some more recent developments that are maybe more broadly of interest to the MFEM community, things like AMR, operator assembly, GPU support that have happened recently. Also, as Will just mentioned, before we get started, PALIS was released as an open source project on GitHub back in February of this year. So somewhat selfishly, if this talk spurs any interest, we would love to get in touch. So don't hesitate to reach out either on GitHub or here as either an end user or a developer. So this is a screenshot here from our blog post that we wrote back in February. You can check it out on the AWS blog. To answer the question of why we built PALIS, or more broadly, what interest does AWS have in finite element codes? This goes back to an early recognition by our team of the heavy need for classical electromagnetic simulation. So using Maxwell's equations to design, to analyze and design components of complete quantum hardware devices. So these are simulations done by end users, designers or scientists or engineers who might not know anything about actual numerical methods, but need them in order to do design. And this leads to two real problems. The first is model scale. The geometries we're concerned with typically have very large ranges of feature sizes. And also we care about long range effects and chip scale simulations. And so the models become very, very large very quickly. And so we need large scale 3D simulations to enable our design work. So this goes hand in hand with requiring solvers that scale well to large problem solvers. So in typical distributed memory environments, take advantage of both algorithmic advancements as well as hardware advancements for HPC so that we can speed up design cycles. And then the second issue that goes alongside model scale is volume. We're exploring large parametric design spaces. And so we need to run lots of models, not just one, in parallel when we can. And we're limited a lot of times by experimental data. And so we're relying very heavily on simulation in these application domains. So in the context of design optimization or uncertainty quantification, et cetera. Workflow automation is super important in this context. So we need to be able to programmatically set up, run simulations in batches, post-process results, things like that. And after a lot of searching, we weren't really able to find commercial or open source tools which felt this need, which we felt met our current needs or future needs. And so we started working on PALIS in our team at AWS about 2.5 years ago. I guess two other notes on the development of PALIS and taking on that burden. First, I guess the risk of building your own solver is greatly improved by the availability of great open source projects like MFEM. So PALIS is built on top of MFEM and also uses libseed. And so we're able to kind of stand on the shoulders of giants here instead of building things up from scratch. And then another benefit of having our own in-house solver is that from the broader AWS point of view, we can kind of use this to explore the capabilities and push the boundaries of cloud-based simulation and cloud-based HPC, which is kind of this new regime that's been the focus of a lot of development from the cloud computing side for the last couple of years. What I'm showing here is a kind of example model in kind of the simplest capacity of things that we care about. So we care about things that are we care about like transmission lines laid out on a substrate. So it's kind of what we're looking at here. And these have kind of coupling between transmission lines as well as resonators and some lumped elements. These are all on a substrate, and then they're kind of modeled in some sort of box with some boundary conditions. So we care about computing things like mode frequencies, coupling, loss, et cetera here. And this is, again, this is the simplest case. So you can imagine arrays of these or chip assemblies or addition of control lines, things like that. And these models become very large very, very quickly. So I want to go through to set some of the stage here, I guess, from the mathematical modeling point of view of what we're interested in PALIS and what PALIS does. And this is kind of important because there's a lot of different ways that you can frame or approximate Maxwell's equations and solve them for different applications based on the boundary conditions or excitations that you care about. In all cases, we're concerned with linear electromagnetics, and we care about full wave simulations, so complete dynamic responses, both in time and frequency domain. We consider here on the top left, the frequency domain case, where we're driving using some boundary excitations. So we have kind of a second order boundary value problem for the complex valued electric field phaser, that's E. We have some inverse permeability as well as permittivity and conductivity. These are in general matrix valued, sometimes complex valued, some perfect electrical conductor Dirichlet boundary conditions, as well as some mixed boundary conditions for absorbing boundaries or lumped boundaries. And then there can be some excitation there from the boundary as well. In the time domain case, we're reusing a lot of the spatial discretization. And so we formulated in as a second order ODE in time. There's also a lot of work for Maxwell's equations, which are doing kind of first order formulations for E and B simultaneously. They're actually quite similar when you use implicit schemes. But we can discretize this using a fully implicit scheme, get unconditionally stable time stepping, because I guess as you saw on the previous slide, the time step limitations for the mesh sizes that we care about when you're caring about very far sub wavelength mesh resolution is really small. So we need fully implicit. And here we can admit kind of the same sequences of boundary conditions and excitations in the time domain. On the right, just kind of an overview of a few kind of features worth calling out that we do that are kind of on top of just the main academic examples. The first is lumped ports. So this is useful for coupling to lumped circuits, as well as computing things like microwave circuit properties like scattering or impedance or admittance parameters in the associated matrices. Numeric wave ports, this is using MFEM submesh capabilities. So you're solving a two-dimensional eigenvalue problem for some boundary mode, and that's used to excite the three-dimensional model. And that's useful also for scattering matrix, scattering parameter calculations. We care about anisotropic boundary or anisotropic material properties, lossy material properties. So in general, the material properties are not constant nor scalar. And then also we have a couple different classes of absorbing boundary conditions. And there could also obviously be more based on the application domains of interest. We also care about eigenmode simulations and solving eigenmode problems. So in the simplest case, you have no loss. And so this K matrix that comes from the curl-curl operator discretization and this M matrix, which comes from the mass term, those are both real and positive semi-definite or positive definite. And so you can use solvers like Hyper's AME or similar types of solvers for that relatively simple case. You have kind of a Hermitian eigenvalue problem. In the general case that we care about, this operator is non-Hermitian, it's complex symmetric, and also we care about the quadratic eigenvalue problem shown here. So after linear, you solve this with linearization, and then we just use standard Arnoldi on the linearized eigenvalue problem. And so this is available in PALIS via SLEPSI or ARPAC. And what you have to do in solving this using shift-invert is you're solving linear systems of the same form as the driven simulation on the previous slide. So you're using a lot of the same linear solver framework to solve kind of a different application domain or different outputs. So where does this get us? This slide here outlines kind of a example of some of the simulation work that we do with PALIS in routine design or analysis. This example was put together in February of 2023 for our blog post. What we're doing here is we're considering this superconducting metamaterial waveguide device, and I kind of have a couple pictures of it around the edge. And so these are made up of chains of these unit cells. Each unit cell is a linear harmonic oscillator in order to achieve some sort of desired frequency response. And so in the simplest case here on the top right, we have a single unit cell. This model has about 242 million degrees of freedom. And then in the most complicated case below it, there's 21 unit cells. And this kind of widens the breadth of your frequency of that plateau in the middle of your filter. And there we have kind of 1.4 billion degrees of freedom. So these are all order two Nedelec elements, pure tetrahedral meshes. There's no partial assembly. This is from February of 2023. So these are kind of an old result. But on the right, on the left here, we can kind of see the electromagnetic field from a from one of the frequency responses, from one of the simulation models. And then in the middle, we're visualizing this, the transmission coefficient. And so we're using, for the transmission coefficient for these driven simulations, we're using kind of an adaptive fast frequency sweep algorithm. We're showing kind of agreement between just a uniform sampling as well as the adaptive sampling, and then using some surrogate model to generate this quickly. In terms of computational performance, these are run all on AWS. That's kind of what we use for our cluster. The largest models here for a billion degrees of freedom are run on 12,000 cores. These are using AWS's HPC instance types. This is the newer ARM-based Graviton 3E cores, HPC 7G instances. These were released kind of back in June of this year. And then for networking, this is taking advantage of a lot of the networking advancements that AWS has done, this Elastic Fabric Adapter. Here on the left and right, these plots are kind of showing wall clock time for the total simulation for both the uniform as well as the adaptive frequency sweeps. As the model complexity grows, we're running at a constant number of degrees of freedom per core. So we're scaling up, kind of, this is a pseudo weak scaling type thing. It's not really weak scaling because the as the model gets more and more complex, you're actually solving harder linear systems. The adaptive frequency sweep is doing more high dimensional solves. And then also you're doing more linear solver iterations, but it's still an idea of how cost scales. Why are there two? So on the left, I'm showing the results from when we originally did these experiments in February, 2023. And on the right, kind of from last week when I reran these prepping for the for this presentation, and you get kind of a nice surprise 2x speed up improvement. And that comes from both the hardware, so we're moving up a generation in instance types, as well as various like incremental improvements in software. And so it kind of emphasizes this, how quickly things can change and how these make real impacts for people running simulations. Factors of two are always welcome. Okay, so now I wanna dive into kind of a couple more broadly, less electromagnetic specific stuff. Maybe more broadly to the MFEM, useful to the MFEM community that we've been working on this year. The first is AMR. There's been a huge amount of work on AMR to get AMR working, I guess, for all the applications we care about. We care about simplex meshes. We also care about mixed meshes. And so we need general non-conforming refinement, coarsening, rebalancing for tetrahedra and prisms and hexahedra. This is a pretty monumental effort worked on by my teammate, Hugh Carson, who I think is here on the line. There's a lot of intricacies to get this working in parallel and make it reliable, and kind of all these edge cases to debug and feature work to add, and lots of corner cases to think about there. But there's been a ton of work on that front. But what we have now is that we can do non-conforming AMR in Palace for high order Nedelec elements with on any sort of element type, mixed meshes. This is all implemented. So here I'm showing kind of for that example model that I had in the original on that first slide. Here's kind of an error indicator as well as a couple levels of refinement. In the middle, we have non-conforming refinement. This is a pure tetrahedral mesh, but it works in a general case. And this is second order H curl elements. And then on the right, we have conforming refinement. So really cool, starting to get some results here. And these are pretty recent. For the error estimation, we're using the same kind of strategies at MFEM. This is this L2ZZ error indicator. So it involves a global mass matrix solve. And so that again reuses a lot of the linear solver stack that I'm going to talk about later. And here's some kind of fresh results of convergence of degrees of freedom, error versus degrees of freedom. We're seeing kind of nice comparisons from the uniform refinement case to the conformal refinement, and then even the non-conformal refinement for tetrahedra getting pretty good efficiency for error versus added degrees of freedom to the system. So these are really promising, and we're really excited to kind of explore this a lot more in the coming weeks. Maybe our end users will too. Okay, so with the last couple minutes here, I'll talk about some more implementation specific stuff, operator assembly and linear solvers. This figure is something that I'm sure many of you are familiar with, and many are experts here in the audience. Tanio actually had it in his initial presentation, but we're using matrix-free P multi-grid preconditioning. This allows us to do kind of high order finite elements with partial assembly, both in the operator application as well as the preconditioner application as much as possible. So some of the, this wasn't, the reason why this isn't just a port is, I guess we want partial assembly for simplex elements, mixed meshes, that's all added. In Palace, we have mixed operators. So not only integrations, but also these discrete interpolators. So discrete gradient, discrete curl, multi-grid prolongation, things like that, all using partial assembly. Boundary integrators with non-square Jacobians, matrix value coefficients, kind of this whole array of features that we needed to add. And this is all built on libseed. So we're kind of using libseed to do operator partial assembly alongside the data structures and stuff like that from Palace. And as was noted earlier, Johan has a talk later on using libseed with MFEM. This is most of the code in Palace is built either built on top of or very highly influenced by his kind of initial work in this regime. A note here on, I guess, partial assembly for simplex elements is, so the thing that changes versus the tensor product implementations in MFEM are this B matrix. You no longer have a sum factorization for applying B, and so you're relying really on optimized dense matrix multiplication. And these dense matrix multiplies are often very rectangular, and so you're doing tricks like batch dense matrix multiplies and things like that in order to get peak performance. This is important for GPU performance, very important for GPUs. But what libseed does is you have access to a lot of these optimized libraries. So libxsmm is an optimized library for doing this on CPUs, and then various magma backend, various customized kernels for smaller values of, for small low order P, and then also just dispatching to kubloss or rockbloss for the larger dense matrix multiplies, makes this fast on GPUs. And that's all available kind of at the level of libseed. And it's kind of pretty cool. Maybe another specific thing here that was unique for this implementation was, this is a slide from 2 years ago, borrowed from Veselin's kind of MFEM community update or MFEM update. You need to kind of be clever about how you do element restriction for high order Nadelec elements with triangular faces, because you have these pairs of degrees of freedom. And so we need to add kind of things like accounting for these orientation flips. Quickly, just before I run out of time, but linear solvers. So I said we're using matrix-free P multigrids. So this is, we're avoiding Gauss-Seidel for all the smoothers. We're using Chebyshev polynomials so that we can, polynomial smoothing, so we can take advantage of partial assembly. For non-static Maxwell problems, we need kind of these auxiliary space smoothers. So we're not only smoothing on the Nedelec space operator, but also the Laplacian in the H1 space. And then you have the discrete gradient to map between the two spaces. So these can all be done with partial assembly. And then for the core solve, we assemble the matrix. It's real valued. And here I'm kind of outlining how we're doing that core solve. For the indefinite frequency domain case, we kind of play this balance of don't coarse in too much so that your core solve, and then you can actually get a long ways by using a parallel sparse direct solver on the coarsest level. And that gets you to still be convergent even at high frequencies. And lastly, final note on performance here, all of the previous slides kind of enable GPU support. So we have kind of support for NVIDIA AMD GPUs via MFEM and via libseed's CUDA HIP backends. And a lot of this stuff is, I guess, still a work in progress in the sense that it works. All the kind of feature completeness is added to the other libraries, but it's not necessarily merged into mainline because there's a lot of performance studying that we kind of want to do in the meantime. But this is kind of how we're able to use Palace on GPUs as a result of all these improvements and for the kind of broad case of applications that we care about. So with that, I'll conclude. I think I have a couple minutes left for questions. Here's a link to the GitHub. Please get involved. We're very open to discussing any sort of contribution ideas or discuss to make Palace kind of more useful to broader ranges of problems. Participation from end users, of course, too. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks very much, Sebastian. Great talk. Really impressive work. And let's see, we've got time for maybe one or two questions from the audience. Questions, anyone?
Hello. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so my question was, Sebastian, have you looked at the LR preconditioner, is there,
So if in order to use LOR, we'd need to be on tensor product meshes. So like we kind of made this early decision of like we could either go the route of tech to hex, So like we're going to do everything as like we're going to split all of our tets and prisms and just use pure hex meshes. And then we can make use of a lot of the machinery of some factorization, LOR, et cetera, or we can explore the route of let's use kind of these more portable frameworks for mixed meshes and develop on top of that. So, and that was kind of based on like, okay, yeah, maybe you take a factor of two or factor of three, you don't have this optimal complex or optimal flop application for the B matrix and partial assembly, but you can kind of build this like maybe pure algebra or more just black box algebraic framework. And so that's the route that we went here. But LOR, yeah, if LOR worked on tets or prisms and mixed meshes, then we could kind of throw it in and use it as opposed to P multigrid directly and use it there. Yeah.
Maybe one day.
Wasn't there some work that you did for synthesis with LR, or this was not really the full LR framework solvers?
That's for solution transfer on mesh. So you can create LOR meshes and discretizations on Simplicity or mixed meshes in MFEM, but you don't get good condition numbers when you precondition.
Oh yeah, okay. There was no optimality, I guess, therefore with respect to P, I guess.
Right.
I guess that's true. You could try and build preconditioners on that space and like see in practice if it's actually that bad, but given, I think the advice from Will was don't do it.
Yeah, it's not, it deteriorates very quickly, at least.
Not yet.
Right.
Okay.
Good question. In the interest of staying on schedule, let's thank Sebastian for the great talk and move on to Jacob.